Guys, today we're going to talk about something to keep you out of heaven. That maybe might okay, y'all with me? Go ahead and get right into two little guys, their brothers, Harry and James. They had just finished their supper. They started playing before bedtime. And Harry, before bedtime, hits James in the head with a stick. Anybody here have kids that argue before bedtime? This is one of those situations where Harry hits James with the stick. James gets mad. He says some things, and tears are flowing. Mom has to step in. How many moms ever been there? Had to step in to stop this issue. Well, finally she comes in and she said, "Now, boys, what would happen if either of you died tonight and you never had the opportunity again to forgive one another?" James spoke up, "Well, okay, I'll forgive him tonight. But if we're both alive in the morning..." That's not the forgiveness I'm talking about, okay? So let's go ahead and look at that. Matthew 18, it starts like this. "Then Peter came to him and asked, 'Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me?'" You do know that Bible is to be applied to us. So remember that. "Seven times?" he asked Jesus. Jesus' response was this: "No, not seven times, but 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who decided to bring his accounts up to date with servants who had borrowed money from him. In the process, one of his debtors was brought in who owed him millions of dollars." Now, this is the NLT. What it does, it applies to what is the relevant way to understand what that amount was. Okay. Millions of dollars. He couldn't pay. No kidding. "So his master ordered that he be sold, along with his wife, his children, and everything he owed, to pay the debt. But the man fell down before the master and begged him, 'Please be patient with me, and I will pay it all.' Then the master, the king, was filled with pity for him, and he released him and forgave his debt." Forgave that debt. Forgave him. Okay, "Then the master was filled with pity for him, released him, forgave him. But when the man left the king, he went to a fellow servant who owed him a few thousand dollars. He grabbed him by the throat," get that picture, "demanded an instant payment." You pay me now. "His fellow servant fell down before him, and if you will allow me to say, told the same thing to him as he told the king. 'Be patient with me, and I'll pay it.' He pleaded." When I use the word creditor, "but the unforgiving servant wouldn't wait. He had the man arrested, put in prison, until the debt could be paid in full. When some of the other servants saw this," there's always somebody else watching, "they were upset. They went to the king, told him everything that had happened, and the king called in the man he had forgiven and said..." Notice what he calls him: "You evil servant. I forgave you that tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant just as I had mercy on you?" Then the angry king sent the man to prison to be tortured until he had paid his entire debt. "That's what my heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and sisters from your heart." This is a story about debt and mercy. It's a story about money and payback. It's a story about forgiveness and unforgiveness. You know, before I really jump into the story, isn't it ironic that money is the problem in this story? Right? How many of you know that money is a problem in our culture? How people think of it. In fact, we know in the Timothy letters that the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. What I want to share with you quickly is something that I heard from a great pastor friend of mine. And he gave these 4 points. How to know when money is not destroying you. Anybody want to hear it? Yes. Number one, let me get right to it. When what you have doesn't have you. Does that make sense? When what you own, like right now, if you're thinking, boy, I sure hope he quits and shuts up because I want to get home and ride and get in my muscle car and go for a ride. You see, at this point, if you're a Christian, hopefully not that you would hear me, that you're hoping that God will talk to you. When you come to church, aren't you hoping God will talk to you? And that's a pretty heavy burden. I know that pastors have, but I just want you to know that God is trying to talk to us. And know this, don't let your possessions own you. Know what they are. If you feel like, I got to have a toy, or I love my toy, I can't wait to get back home so I can play video games. How much do you need Jesus? Because Jesus should be a whole lot more important than what you own. Secondly, what you don't have doesn't bother you. If you're out there thinking, man, I cannot wait until I get that next car. I cannot wait until I get a better house. I'm tired of this old nasty house I'm in. I just can't wait to get that next thing. You know, the situation is, so many people are so stuck in waiting for that next thing. You do know everything rusts and decays, no matter what you get. Here's what I found out. Houses have like hot water heater problems. Anybody here know that? How many of you know that occasionally I have to go inflate a tire on that nice car? All I'm saying is everything the world has to offer. Don't let it bother you that you don't have it. Be glad with what Jesus has given you. And listen, just as our church is being blessed, God's going to bless you. Hang on. You just wait. Okay, third thing is this. When people are more valuable to you than money itself. People are more important than money. Right? When I leave this world, do I want to leave money for my family? Yes. But I want my family more than I want that money. I want to bless my family. I do. I'm not saying retirement and all that kind of stuff. No, go for it. But know this, it's all for a purpose. Jesus is more important than money. People, my wife is more important than money, right? So when people are more valuable, my children, I have my youngest child on the front row that she now, I'm embarrassing her. And so she is, she's nodding. And she just kind of just doesn't talk to me for a while. But I'm making it worse. I love her. I love this girl. I love my kids. And as much as I can, I love you guys. Aren't you glad you go to this church? I mean, some of you will say no. It's okay. We hope you find the place you need to be. But I love you. I love this family. I love our Sunday school teachers because they're awesome. I love John and Jody. I love them. They're awesome. I want you to know, it's not because of them. It's because of the God they love. Because John loves people. Jody loves kids. And we should love each other. So if money's more important than people, you might have a money problem. And last but not least, when you can celebrate with those who have been blessed by God. You know, if God blesses somebody else financially, it's like this morning. We gave Coma, I still can't believe it, we gave Coma over $40,000. Somebody might be out there saying, boy, I wish somebody blessed me with $40,000. You know, we rejoice. We rejoice with them because they're going to make a difference in the world. Okay, I just threw that out to you. Hopefully you can use that. It's a way to gauge how you're doing. Let's get right to the story. The story goes like this. Let me talk about the people in the story. Peter. Peter approaches Jesus with a question in his view of forgiveness. Peter was not without warrant for this suggestion. Got to tell you something. It's kind of impressive. Put into the rabbinic Jewish history, he was actually doing something very, very cool. If you go to the first two chapters of Amos, you'll find out that in the rabbinical law, you are supposed to forgive up to three times. So Peter, oh man, he's going to one-up them. No. Hey, Jesus, how about seven times? I'm going to double it and add one for good measure. And then Jesus says, wrong, gong. Anybody remember the gong show? Of course, the three of you might remember. But then you have Jesus who tells him, no, 70 times 7. You know, Jesus then told the story of a servant given a great debt who went out and dealt mercilessly, and a fellow servant who owed him a debt. Then you have the king. The king in this parable, he wants to settle his accounts. Let me just stop and make a commercial. You do know that all of us someday will have to settle the accounts. We all will stand, for it is appointed unto man once to die, then will come the accounting of our lives. So I'm on good biblical ground to say Jesus is telling us the story of the Father as the king. Right? So you have the king wanting to settle his accounts. Payments are due. He's a king of justice, but yet we see him as a king of forgiveness. He starts to sell the servant and all that he had, but the king had compassion, released him, wrote off the debt. Then you have that servant who owed the king 10,000 talents. We'll get to that in just a second. Equaling millions. Not having the money, the king commanded him to be sold and his family and their possessions. The servant begs the king, please give me time to pay. King forgave him, forgave that debt. That debt. What's interesting is that servant leaves and immediately comes across another servant parallel to him, another servant who owes him 100 denarii. That amount of money, here in a second I'll show you the comparison, does not at all relate to one and the other. So he grabs him by the throat. You owe me 100 denarii. I want it now. I don't have it. Please, please. Tells the same thing. Please give me some time. I'll pay you back. No, you're going to prison. Throws him in prison. And so then there's always somebody watching. There's the other servants. And they say, hey, didn't he get forgiven for millions? You see, this is that role of hypocrisy in life and church. Wasn't that guy seriously in sin and the Lord saved him? And what's he doing now? Let's take it back to the story. Didn't that guy get forgiven and released of millions of dollars debt? And look how he just treated his brother. Think we need to go tell the king. So they run to the king and they tell him, give me some liberty to say what happens. He calls in the unforgiving servant and he said, this is what I'm adding to the parable. Tell me what I just heard is not true. In my mercy, I extended to you something you could never pay back. And you treated somebody, right after I taught you a lesson on mercy, you offered none. Tell you what we're going to do. It's not only are we going to throw you in prison and your wife and your kids and all your possessions, but you're going to be tortured. Now, I'm telling the biblical story. Nobody wants to hear that, but guys, whether we like it or not, there is a heaven, there is a hell, so we have to talk about that. Kind of get an amen in the house. So what we have are all these characters themselves, collectively. Here's the moral of the story. We are the servants. Father is the king. Can I get an amen? Amen. All of us owe a debt that must be paid, and only the king can forgive that debt. Because the debt is impossible to pay. And the king won't forgive our debt if we only forgive those who owe us with a true heart. Here are the points. Here are the non-negotiables. Number one, our debt is unmatched. We must forgive in order to be forgiven. Amen. The first servant owed his master 10,000 talents. And a talent was worth 15 years of salary. Do the math. I did, and I'm not smart enough. No. 10,000 times 15. That's why in the NLT it says millions. And in fact, here in a second, I'm going to show you what it would look like if the 10,000 talents were made into small coins and those 100 denarii were made into small coins. What's the difference? And I'm going to show you because God wants us to see it. See, the debt which the fellow servant owed, 100 denarii, was usually, each denarii was a day's wage for a working man. So 100 days' wage. It was therefore a mere fraction of the debt. So here, let's suppose we do that in small coins. The 100 denarii debt could possibly be carried in the pocket of the person who owes the money. Now, it'd be a pretty good size pocket. 100 pennies in my pocket would lead you to believe I have a tumor. Okay, but here's the deal. It can be carried in a pocket. Now, the 100,000 talent debt, it would take an army of 8,600 men to each carry a 60-pound bag. Are you with me? A 60-pound bag in the weight, and if the men were stretched 1 meter apart, the line would be 5 miles long. Now do you get it? The king says, I forgive 5 miles of 8,600 men carrying 60 pounds of coins. I forgive you. You owe me 100 days' wage. Now open up your pocket and pay me. Says it took him by the throat. And because you don't have it with you, please help me. No, you're going to jail. There's a reason for Christ using that comparison. You see, again, our debt is unmatched. The point is that nothing that others can do. Listen, the point is that nothing that others can do to us can in any way compare to what we have done to God. In our sin. You see, if God has forgiven us the debt we owe Him, we must forgive our neighbors and debts that they owe us. You see, this is kind of like the tag. Let our sinful shame fan our forgiving flame of faith. You see, the second one is His mercy is undeserving. That first guy didn't deserve that. He didn't deserve the debt being forgiven. Colossians 2:13, you were dead because of your sins and because your sinful nature was not yet cut away. Then God made you alive with Christ, for He forgave all our sins. He canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. Anybody want to say amen? Anybody want to say thank you, Jesus? Anybody want to say praise God? He forgave millions in my life. You see, getting to heaven takes forgiveness. A two-way street. Isn't that what the story tells us? God extends to us free and total forgiveness. The only thing we are to do in response to His forgiveness, and according to the story, is this. You must offer mercy and forgiveness to everyone who has wronged you. I am not stupid. I'm not naive. It's not easy. So I'm not going to play with some idealistic point that shame on you, shame on you. The devil is good at what he does. And the devil is the one, which, by the way, that's one of the points that's coming. So I don't want to waste my time there. Double it up later. But His mercy is undeserving. We don't deserve salvation. You can't earn it in a way that you can be good enough. You can't be good enough. Because the Bible says in Romans 5:12 that you were born with sin. So you got to deal with that. And so as we know this, let's let His forgiveness fuel our witness. Number three, our debt is connected to a murder. You see, we have been forgiven a debt which is beyond all paying. For human sin brought about the murder of the death of God's own Son. And if that is so, we must forgive others as God has forgiven us, or we can hope to not find any mercy. Let me put it this way. Pastor, I'm not a bad guy, but you're still a murderer. That's what the Bible says. Every one of us were represented at Calvary. Our sin killed Jesus Christ. So how can you explain somebody who's wronged you where you have killed God's Son? Are you with me? Theologically, I'm not off. This is legitimate. You see, as we get to this, listen, James 2:13, there will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when He judges you. You guys with me? This is a serious message, and somehow I wish some of you more qualified could come in here and help me preach this, but it's a non-negotiable. Forgiveness has changed the world. It has. So as we talk of the negative, I want to get to the positive of how forgiveness can not only change the world, but change you. We have to let God's justice be our compass. Okay, let me hit this real fast. His mercy is found in the cross. Can I get an amen? Okay, now, how many times can you or will you forgive your dog? Okay, I have made a segue now for me to talk about stuff that I really want to talk about in my house. Okay, how many times can now I'm not going to give you all of the huge 3-page list of the things that I can complain about when it comes to pets. I love my pets. I just don't always like to be with them. Connie laughs. Sometimes it's good to send them to Connie's. But if you had a dog that messed on your carpet 3 times a day for 3 straight months. Okay, yeah. You're kind of getting it. I want you to know something. If I love that dog, I'm good for a couple weeks. But the next time my wife wakes me up and says, honey, he did it again, I'm going to do what my dad did. See, my dad taught me how to get rid of dogs in more ways than others. Now, please, please know this. I am not dogging my dog. One of my dogs. But let me put it this way. Dad said, we got to get rid of this. This dog was making a mess all over. Well, so he drove the dog. We lived in Chillicothe. He drove the dog to Bainbridge on a country road. Yes, I'm that guy. Dad took me in the car, told me what we're going to do. He was supposedly teaching me a lesson on how to get rid of dogs. So we take the dog to Bainbridge, drop it off. The next morning, the dog was at our house. 20 miles away, that dog somehow got back. I think he was running thinking, I'll wait till they see me again. You know, all I'm saying is, but there reaches a point where, in the 845 service, Mike Castle did this. I was saying, what about if this dog messed on your carpet all these times? Here's what he said. How many times are we willing to forgive our dogs? And we won't forgive somebody whose soul and somebody whose life could keep us from heaven. I think so. So guys, when we talk about His mercies and the cross, God's love and forgiveness is astounding. Please get this. What He was, the King was willing to forgive, we can't pay back. He gets, and do you know this, that Jesus gets hurt when we sin? But yet He loves us anyway. He won't give up. Why do I know that? Because the Bible says in the Old Testament that every morning He renews His mercy. God loves you. God loves you. God's love is unconditional, like no other love. God's love is never ending. It doesn't run out if we keep messing up. But God wants to change us and move in it. But His love is the motivation. And I want you to know something. Love is a whole lot better than judgment. So let the cross be our daily destination. Let me close with this. We're about done. How mercy changes our lives. Number one, the key to getting to heaven is forgiveness. Non-negotiable. Non-negotiable. Say it with me. Non-negotiable. I will not get to heaven without forgiveness. Say it. I will not get to heaven without forgiveness. Don't forget what Jesus said in his Lord's Prayer. Father, forgive us our debts. Finish it. As we forgive our debtors. Number two, every successful family will practice mercy. If you want a strong marriage, practice mercy. If you want a strong parenting relationship with your kids, show mercy. Let me tell you something. Children need to learn mercy from their parents and grandparents. Can I get an amen? Guys, a great family has begun the practice of mercy. Kids need to see dads and moms apologize to their spouse. We're teaching them something. We need to show forgiveness. Even when our kids do things that when they make poor choices, it's a part of, yeah, you did something wrong. And I take that. The men in the house that are dads, we take the responsibility. Sometimes we got to be the hammer. But you don't have to be the hammer with no love. And if this is a non-negotiable, that means heaven is full of forgiving people. And forgiveness, again, goes both ways. The fruit of the enemy is unforgiveness. 2 Corinthians 2, when you forgive this man, this is Paul talking, I forgive him too. And when I forgive whatever needs to be forgiven, I do so with Christ's authority for your benefit. Verse 11, so that Satan will not outsmart us. We are familiar with his evil schemes. Notice the word evil here. The same word that you'll find in the story of the unforgiving servant. Satan is evil. His job is to use unforgiveness. Make you unforgiving. That's the devil's evil, quote, servant, you are evil. The fruit of the enemy is unforgiveness. So let it go. Number four, please hear this. Fallen believers need mercy to get back home. Does anybody here know somebody that used to go to church but doesn't go to church now? And they left ugly. Or they left in sin. How are they going to get back? How are we going to get them back? Pointing fingers at them? Oh, you're that guy. Pastor told me about you. You're going someplace else, right? Because we don't want you back at Heritage. You know what? Here's what I found out. People that have left church will jump to other churches to somehow find that which they long for to take away their guilt. And it really doesn't happen within necessarily the church as it does within the heart of the person. And how do they change? When we show them mercy. Are you with me? We help backsliders get back because we don't hold something against them. We say, we love you. Come back. Now, you don't have to come back the way you left. Please don't come back the way you left. But we want you to know some of us are praying for you. Some of us love you. And all of us love you. We want you back. Right? We get that? And there are way too many backslidden people. I love you, Jennifer. But we're moving on. And last, as the praise team comes out, the King's mercy can change the brokenness of the world. Let me ask you something. How many of you, look at me, every one of you look at me. How many of you can remember the day you prayed to be saved? How many of you can remember the day you gave your heart to Christ? Okay, let me just simply ask you this. Have you changed since that day? Look over here, not them, they're pretty people, but look over here. Choose ugliness for a minute. Okay? Did God change your world? Yes. Did you become a new creature in Christ? Yes, sir. Are you somebody blessed by the blood of Jesus Christ? Yes. It changed your world. So how do we change the world? We help share that message that we forgive. We are a forgiving people because our God is a forgiving person and a forgiving God. And I'm telling you what, we can change the world. God's given us the Great Commission so that we can change the world. Yes. Amen. Yes. Now I want you to stand. Now what I'm going to do is something different than I've done in the past. I am going to pray what's called a prayer of response. During that prayer, if you feel like God has touched your heart, spoken to you that you need to pray about something, I want you to come during the prayer. Okay? Okay? Say okay. Or I'll be here forever. Okay. Bow your heads, close your eyes. How many out there would say, Pastor, you have preached on something that is an issue in my life? Raise your hand. That's what I thought. Put them down. Okay, look up. Guys, just like the 845, I would say at a minimum 50 plus people. You just took the courage. Tell me. It's a problem in my life. Jesus knows the King. And the King will forgive your debt. But if you want to get to heaven, let it go. Let it go. What is it on this planet you need to get out of that compared to what God is offering for heaven? So what we're going to do is I'm going to pray a prayer, and that prayer is going to basically remind us that God would bless us in the things that we've heard from the Word today. And during that time, if you want to come. And also, let me also say this. After the service is even over and the worship's over, I'm going to stay here. So if anybody wants to pray and wants to talk to individually, we've got people that'll be here. Okay? So the altar time is actually bigger than it used to be. During the prayer time, you can come. After the service, you can come. Okay? But let's pray. Lord Jesus, I want to tell you, thank you, Lord, for these good people. Thank you. Lord, we know that our debt is unmatched and your mercy is undeserved. God, our debt is connected to the death of Jesus. Oh, God, I can't fathom that I'm partially responsible for the death of Jesus. Lord, your mercy, though, is seen in the cross. So, God, would you apply this? If somebody is here today that has said no to Jesus because they have said yes to unforgiveness, they can't forgive somebody. Save them today. Open their eyes, Lord, to their spiritual condition. Let them see how much, Lord, you love them. You want to help them. Put the Holy Spirit in their heart to give them the power to forgive. Help us, Lord, to practice forgiveness at home and in our relationships. God, help us to know where unforgiveness comes from. It's the enemy. Help us to blame him and not somebody else. Lord, help the backslidden and the prodigal souls who have left. Bring them back by mercy, we pray. And God, change our broken world. Please, change our broken world and use us as visuals of what mercy can look like. We ask this, Lord, believing you'll help and you'll touch them. In Christ's name, and everybody said, amen. Hey, we've had a day to celebrate today. So what I've done is I've asked the praise team, they're going to sing again that last song they sung. It's a brand new one. This is a celebration song. Let's end this service in a way that God deserves our celebration and our worship. Amen, amen, amen. Let's do it.
God is good, amen. All my life, all I know, God's been good to my soul.